officials. And lo and behold, here we are 14 years later, and she's our acting undersecretary. And she approaches that job with the same seriousness of purpose, the same team orientation. It's been just remarkable to watch her value the expertise of the career service and to really bring the best that she can from her perspective and the best that we can as career officials together to really accomplish something for the department. So it's a great pleasure to introduce our acting undersecretary, my friend Heather Nauer.
She's the best. We're so lucky to have been able to bring on Elizabeth. We'll do the Mutual Admiration Society for just a moment. We recently brought on Elizabeth, a career Foreign Service officer, back from the Foreign Service Institute to become the deputy spokesperson here. And that gets me to one of the things I'd like to address with all of you. I came in as a political appointee into this administration 13, 14 months ago and did not know what to expect. I'd never served in government before, much less for a big institution like this. When I first came in, I thought, oh gosh, the hardest part is going to be dealing with my State Department colleagues. They're not going to like me. They're not going to like a woman who's working for this administration. They're not going to like a woman coming out of television. And that's really what I expected from this building. What I got was the complete opposite. I have been able to succeed to a certain extent over the last year because of you, because of my Foreign Service and Civil Service colleagues. Like Elizabeth, our Press Office Director, Robert Greenan, who served most recently in Vienna, they are wonderful. Everyone has supported me along the way, and my original thoughts about what the State Department would be like were completely unfounded. So day one, I walked in the door, met all of you, and your job here was really to help me, to help the United States, and I'm just so grateful for the professionalism that everyone, and kindness that everyone has shown. So Elizabeth, thank you for that introduction. And thank you to Ambassador Todd for inviting me to speak with all of you today. I want to extend a warm welcome to all the members of our Foreign Affairs family who've returned to the State Department to celebrate the 53rd anniversary of Foreign Affairs Day. I have heard some fascinating stories from many of you already today. Ambassador Beecroft, you talked about your service, your commitment to our nation, having served in Bosnia, as you were telling me, for 5 years in an unaccompanied post. So, sir, thank you for your service. Everything old is new again, as we spoke about Russian disinformation, which you know very well. We could certainly use your expertise from what you handled years ago. I assume many of you worked on that issue as well, so we're dealing with that. Ambassador Chacon is our ambassador in residence at Duke University, bringing on the future generation of Foreign Service. We need you now more than ever, bringing in so many young people. And we were pleased to be able to showcase our new A100 class that was, Ambassador, a month ago or so. And I love seeing these A100 students because they're so fresh-faced. They haven't been beaten down by Washington or careers just yet. They haven't been sent out to foreign posts, but they are just such a delight to get to meet and see them on their way. I'd like to express my congratulations to Richard Green and also Ambassador Kenny for receiving the Director General's Cup. Congratulations, well deserved. Your distinguished careers, both at the State Department and after in your service to your communities, are an inspiration to us all. Thank you for that. Since joining the State Department more than a year ago, I've been consistently impressed by the talent, ingenuity, and the work ethic exhibited by my Foreign Service and Civil Service colleagues, who steadfastly advance America's interests around the globe. The Department enjoys a wonderful reputation, an impressive reputation, both here at home and abroad with governments as well as the publics abroad. So, and that is thanks in part to the careers that you have all held over so many years and the legacy that you've left behind. There are so many who now follow in your footsteps. I mentioned the A100 class. People sometimes say that I have the toughest job in the building. I would say after observing our new secretary over the past week, he has the toughest job in the building. I have literally been sworn in, and within, I think it was an hour, hopping on the plane, and what impressed me the most about Secretary Pompeo is that he had only met the people on the plane a handful of times of that. I had met him twice.
brief conversations each time. But he stepped on the plane without anyone from his former career, without anyone who had worked with him in Congress, without anyone from the agency. Who was on the plane staffing him? State Department employees. It was a combination of civil service, foreign service, and political. Just a handful of us. So imagine that. You're fourth in line to the presidency. Your first big trip overseas as the Secretary of State, after we've had a very challenging year at the State Department. And he trusts the State Department professionals to do their jobs. And so often on that trip, I would ask my more senior colleagues, well, do you think I should ask the secretary this? Do you think I should do that? And they'd say, he trusts you. You're a professional. He trusts all of us. Just do your job. And I think we're going to see so much of that from him over the next coming years, trusting our colleagues to do what they do best and what they know best. So I am just beyond thrilled to have Secretary Pompeo on this team. All of your jobs have been truly tough jobs. I'd also like to recognize our Foreign Service and Civil Service colleagues who are serving in very difficult posts overseas. Our first press office director when I arrived here, his name is Mark Stroh. Mark helped get me up to speed with the briefings, which was not easy. And Mark is now serving in Syria. And he is there as a part of our Forward Start program, which many of you, I think, are probably familiar with. He is serving in certainly a difficult environment, as are our people in Bangladesh, for example, where it's a difficult security environment. Doesn't get a lot of attention, but it certainly is, and it's an unaccompanied post. So I think of our colleagues who do those tough jobs, whether it's a secretary and always having to be on, or my former colleague, Mark Strella, will always be grateful to him for his wonderful work on Syria. So the dedication, the expertise, and experience of the department's career staff is among our nation's most valuable asset in achieving America's foreign policy goals, bolstering our national security and prosperity, and promoting America's image and values abroad. Secretary Pompeo is sincere in his commitment to respect, trust, and empower the department's foreign service and civil service staff. He has faith in people at the department to do their jobs. Another thing I want to mention to you that he shared with me on the last trip is he said, Heather, I want to do a better job of telling our story overseas. And isn't it that exactly what U.S. Information Agency used to do so many years ago? It's something that needs to be done once again. And I don't say put together a new agency, but it's something that the department can always better do. Tell our story. There is no nation that has better served the world than the United States of America. Whether it's our ideals, our values, our assistance, our dedication to humanitarian aid, standing up and doing the right thing, in helping people who are suffering, there's nobody who does it better than the United States. So one of the things that he's asked me to do is to help achieve that goal in better empowering our people to tell that story. And he brought that up with me, and I have the hugest smile on my face. So really looking forward to assisting the Secretary in any capacity with that. I'd like to make another observation about the trip with Secretary Pompeo, and I know that you'll hear from him later, so you'll hear it in his own words, but sometimes it's interesting to hear from an observer. My next observation from this trip relates to his appreciation for the need to communicate with our constituencies. And if you think about the constituencies we have a lot of them, our colleagues here at the State Department, at the interagency, who are always looking for a policy steer. The media, they're a constituency, whether we like them or not. If we don't feed that beast, they will find something to write about. So it's our job to provide them with factual, accurate content, and the Secretary is committed to that. Congress, another important constituency. Well, you don't want them cranky, right? I'm sure many of you have heard that through the years, how cranky they can become. They always want to know what we're up to, of course, as stewards of the public dollar. Our allies and partners, and also our adversaries. We can make it clear to them exactly where we stand, what our priorities are, and when we call them out. The American people, of course, deserve to know how we are spending their tax dollars. And that is something that the Secretary knows very well. Our trip started to NATO, and then we headed to Saudi Arabia, to Israel, and then Jordan. It was a whirlwind, three countries in one day. I'm sure many of you have done that as well before. But the trip started with six members of our press corps. And by the end of the trip, we picked up two others. And so that really generated a lot of goodwill with our press corps. Starting with six, picking it up to eight, we just bumped into them in Brussels and said, come on board, we have extra seats on the plane. So I think we're really off to a great start. I hope that you have been proud of the press coverage that we've received over the last week with Secretary Pompeo. It isn't always going to be positive. There will always be different difficult things ahead of us, but I want you to know he gets it. He understands the importance of communicating with the press for those constituencies that I mentioned. As you know better than anyone, we are facing some very serious foreign policy challenges. We have new rivals, new risks, terror organizations. They morph, they recalibrate, cyber warfare, disinformation, as the ambassador and I had spoken about at our table. And some of the risks remain too. We have nuclear weapons, of course, in the hands of unpredictable adversaries, regional power rivalries, I could go on and on. So given those challenges that we are facing today, the art of diplomacy is as crucial, as indispensable as it has ever been. Secretary Pompeo is dedicated to ensuring we're all working together and is confident in our capabilities. A particular aspect of diplomacy that I want to address with you is our enduring value of public diplomacy and the tools that enable us to connect America to those audiences abroad, shape their opinions, and promote our values and safeguard our interests. I would like to recognize someone who's sitting in this audience who certainly embodies that today, the spirit of her and her husband, Harriet Fulbright. Are you here today? How many students have been able to take advantage of that program, and what a wonderful example that sets of America's values abroad. So thank you. Thank you for coming and honoring us with your presence. Secretary Pompeo knows the importance of that, whether it's the Fulbright program or the International Visitors Leadership Program. I just learned the other day that the heads of state from the Baltics, from Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania were all involved with their International Visitors Leadership Program, which is incredible. Think of all the work that we can do to help educate people about our values and how that really pays off. And now we have such strong, strong relationships. As you saw, the heads of those countries meet with the president about a month ago and met with Secretary Tillerson just prior to that. So we really have a great relationship with that. I'd like to mention, get back to it for a second, some of what Secretary Pompeo shared with me about the importance of reaching out and telling our story overseas. And we do have such an incredible story to tell, not just from our values, but also the literal work that we are doing on the ground. Has anyone here ever served with population refugees and migration? Did any of you ever serve with them? PRM? Well, yes, of course, sir. I'm sorry. So I had the wonderful opportunity of heading to Bangladesh with PRM. And that is where we saw firsthand the Rohingya refugees and how they were pushed out, essentially, of Burma and into Bangladesh. And the generosity of the government of Bangladesh for bringing them in to so many of them over a short period of time into their country. And the importance which our relationship with the country of Bangladesh, because they're willing to host these people. So I just wanted to recognize the great work that PRM has done and the great story that we have to tell about American generosity, but also recognizing that stable countries make for a stable region, makes for a more stable world. By building a network of supporters aligned with America's cause, as I think we're doing with Bangladesh and other countries, we make it politically possible for foreign governments to side with the United States on sensitive policy issues and affirm our continued leading role on the world stage. Building these networks requires a strategic long-term effort using the full range of diplomatic public diplomacy tools and programs at our disposal. That now includes social media. Secretary Pompeo, for those of you who are on Twitter, has a Twitter account. So I would encourage you to sign up for it. It is at Sec Pompeo. And that is another way that he recognizes the importance of communicating. I would like to mention back to this Bangladesh trip again. I went to one of our American spaces, and that was an incredible opportunity to see so many young people gathered in one location where they were thinking about where they wanted to go to college. And I remember walking in late after a long trip. I was on my way to the airport. That was our last stop. And I walked in, and there was this room of young people, just all at their computers, and they were applying to colleges. And they had all the college banners that had all the names of the different schools up there. And it was wonderful to meet so many of these young people, and I was able to talk to them a little bit about the schools. I said, oh, Arizona State, that's a party school. Oh, Harvard, that's a good one, you want to go there. But to talk with them about the types of schools in the United States was just a terrific opportunity, and really, really enjoyed that. I wanted to mention that we are improving coordination of public diplomacy efforts across our bureaus and offices by sharing common functions, and we are capitalizing on comparative strengths. I'd like to provide another example, and this gets back into disinformation, but the Global Engagement Center. It's the newest member of the department's public diplomacy family. Its role is leading, coordinating, and deconflicting our efforts to counter disinformation and malign propaganda across an array of regional and functional bureaus, as well as the interagency. You may have read about the Global Engagement Center recently in the papers. We've not gotten the best press, but we are turning things around. We are in the process of getting funding from DOD. I just had a meeting with my counterpart at DOD earlier today, and that funding is in the pipeline. Our priority is state-sponsored disinformation. We've already gotten approval to work specifically on Russian disinformation. And thanks to Ambassador Todd, we were able to get 13 new hires. And of course, many of you know about the hiring freeze, but it was 13 new hires under the national security exemption. So Ambassador, thank you for doing that. It may not sound like a whole lot, mean a lot to our efforts to counter propaganda. And by the way, the Hill loved it. So Secretary Pompeo and I have had numerous discussions about this effort. It's helping to reduce overlap, duplication, identify gaps, and strengthen our overall effectiveness in countering those who wish to mislead or sow confusion. There are a lot of ways in which we are doing this to work together, not just at the State Department, but also at the interagency. So I think we have a wonderful future together here at the State Department. I've said the word wonderful many times here, but it really is. I think it shows, I hope my enthusiasm about Secretary Pompeo and the work that you do here at the State Department shows. Thank you for the opportunity of serving my country. I've said to my husband, the two highlights of my life have been, one, the birth of my two young boys, and then second, taking my oath. And it's something that, and I know you know exactly what I'm talking about. And no slight to my husband that it wasn't our wedding day, but thank you all. Thank you for your support, your encouragement along the way, and I hope to get a chance to meet so many more of you. Thank you for your service to our country and for having me.
HR team in the audience, so if you can just raise your hand, we've got folks with microphones, they'll find you, and I think we have about 15 minutes for Q&A. So good news,